Good morning and welcome to this conference on this very warm Canberra day here at ANU at the National Security College here in the Crawford Building. It's my real pleasure to welcome you. I'm Rory Medcalf. I'm head of the National Security College and you'll hear a bit more from me shortly. I just wanted to say one or two things before I introduce the Vice Chancellor of the University, Professor Brian Schmidt, to officially open proceedings. Just a reminder that the conference today on strengthening Australia-Japan-US security cooperation, challenges and prospects in the Indo-Pacific is very much on the record, so please bear that in mind as you make comments throughout the day. Please also now put your mobile phones on silent. Don't turn them off if you feel like tweeting, because we are on the public record and we would like to generate debate with the event today. I'll say a little bit more shortly, but to begin with, I'd like to welcome and introduce Professor Brian Schmidt, the Vice Chancellor of ANU. Now, Professor Schmidt needs little introduction to most of you. He's the 12th Vice Chancellor of ANU, and it's, I think, 12 months precisely since you've taken the helm. Among other things, driving, I think, a very engaged approach by ANU to policy and to challenges out there in the world, and there are plenty of those at the moment I suspect we'll reflect on as the day goes on. Regarding Professor Schmidt's academic career, not a lot I need to say. He was awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics in 2011. I probably won't say more, but I think that speaks for itself. Professor Schmidt, please, over to you.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the ANU. Before we start, I'd like to acknowledge and celebrate the first Australians on whose traditional lands we meet today, pay my respects to the elders of the Ngunnawal people, past and present. Welcome to this conference on trilateral security cooperation between Australia, Japan, and the United States, hosted here at the ANU. And this is exactly the type of event we like to do at ANU. And I cannot think of a more important time to be doing things like this, as the normal political channels, at least from my observation posts, are a little clogged compared to what they normally are. It's obviously most timely for us to be meeting to discuss the future strategic environment here in the Indo-Pacific region, and especially the role that the United States and its allies can play in maintaining security and stability. It almost goes without saying that U.S. allies such as Australia and Japan will be watching very closely the decisions, declarations coming out of Washington in the months, days, weeks ahead. In this world of complex change and apparent unpredictability, the intersection of what happens inside nations, what happens in the wider world of geopolitics is increasingly evident and important. That nexus of domestic and international security is where the National Security College, or NSC, seeks to make a special contribution to policy teaching and research. It's a unique institution here in Australia and the world, and a joint initiative between the Australian government and this university. From my point of view, it's one of those parts of the ANU where we can simultaneously be a great university and make policy impact. In doing so, it leverages its links with other parts of the university, such as, for example, our College of Engineering and Computer Science on cybersecurity, working with the College of Asian Pacific Studies and the ANU Strategic and Defense Studies Center in teaching, research, and outreach. The National Security College pursues its mission to improve the quality of policy and policy thinking in three ways. First, through executive professional education. Almost 3,000 Australian officials have been trained since 2010. And I also note that we're working with other institutions. Earlier this month, we signed an MOU on behalf of the university with a leading Japanese institution, the Graduate Institute of Policy Studies, which will enable us to have joint activities, such as joint delivery and executive training courses in Japan, Australia, or third countries. Secondly, the NSC has achieved significant growth in academic education and research, including master's and PhDs programs. It may be unfortunately signed at the times, but the Masters of National Security registered one of ANU's fastest growing enrollments in 2016. It is indeed interesting times. And third, through policy engagement such as trustable roundtable discussions and publications with practical recommendations, such as a paper released last week on how Australia should respond to the Trump administration. Another way that the NSC seeks to make an impact on policy and the international debate is through public events like today's conference. Last year, the NSC convened four international conferences, including one on Indo-Pacific maritime security that had speakers such as Admiral Scott Swift, the commander of the U.S. 7th Fleet, who I had a good chance to meet. Today, I'm pleased once again to see the NSC working with the support of the Japanese embassy, and I note the ambassador, Japanese ambassador, welcome again to the ANU, to foster policy discussions around regional security challenges and opportunities. I welcome our distinguished international speakers, including former Japanese Minister for Defense, Professor Satoshi Morimoto, Dr. Amy Seawright, the former U.S. Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense. We'll be hearing from you in just a second. And I wish you well with your discussions today. I thank you all for bringing your work and being willing to work with here at ANU and the National Security College in creating a tangible bridge between academia and policy. Now is the time for this to occur. We need to have discussions. They do have the opportunity to have big impact. So I wish you well in your discussions. I look forward to seeing the outcomes of today and understanding better how you all think, the experts, things are going to go, because I have to admit it's of intense interest, not just for me as a physicist, but I think the entirety of Australia and this part of the world. So good luck today, and my best of luck in your discussions.
I think the candor and frankness in the conversation that we're going to have today will reinforce the value of allies and partners talking to one another and frankly helping one another help themselves and also help allies and partners from harming their own interests in some circumstances too. So with that note, I'm going to segue straight into our first session, our first formal session for the conference. We have three, I think, really excellent speakers for this session who represent through their own careers not only the trilateral relationship among Australia, the United States and Japan, but also that intersection of practical policy and policy leadership, security practice, and also deep academic and policy thinking about the issues of concern. So for this first session, I'm going to introduce our speakers. I'll begin with the Honourable Satoshi Morimoto, former Minister of Defence from Japan, who I think joined us only yesterday. I hope you had a restful journey, Professor. We welcome Professor Morimoto because his own experience as Minister of Defence for Japan, but also more recently as Senior Advisor or Special Advisor to the Japanese Foreign Minister and a number of other roles in really helping to inform relationships in the region has really, I think, had an impact on the security partnership between Australia and Japan and with the United States. I note also that Professor Morimoto is no stranger to academia as well, and among other roles at the moment serves as, I believe, the Chancellor of Takushoko University in Japan, but has also worked in very other distinguished roles in policy and academia throughout his career. So Professor Morimoto, I'll invite you to give some opening remarks. This session, just to remind you, is on the record and is very much about setting the scene so that we can take stock of the quality, the strength, and the challenges for the key relationships Australia-Japan, but also US-Japan, US-Australia alliances. Please, Professor Morimoto, the floor is yours.
First of all, on behalf of our people, I would like to great thanks to the Australian side, especially Prime Minister Turnbull, Receiver Minister Abe, very warmly. And now the Japan-Australia relationship is coming to the new stage of a very close security partnership and cooperative relationship between both countries. I have some experience when I was a defense minister. I joined a 2+ meeting in 2012 in Sydney, not here. But after we arrived to the Sydney, I have received a message from a prime minister. Okay, two ministers should be back as soon as possible to Tokyo because the Chinese ships are coming to Senkaku. Then we have a quick discussion with the Australian side and took a 5-minute shower in a hotel room. Our trip was a 3-day trip, no stay. And so I have a very bad impression to the Sydney, but this is Canberra, and I'm very comfortable. Especially we have a very excellent new defense minister, Tokyo. If North Korea launch a new type of ICBM against us, I think a new defense minister can deal with very well. But anyway, we had many change and confusion on the last 10 days since inauguration day of new US President Trump in Washington. We have sought many perspective and a huge prospect which we might not have if Hillary won the election. So in this context, I think we have to say a great thanks to Mr. Trump. But Japanese media relatively critical to Mr. Trump's behavior and policy guideline. However, we have to think about how the reward enjoyed by United States for its war in especially Afghanistan, Iraq, and other places in Middle East was a growing anti-Americanism and financial deficit and popular war fatigue. Then many Americans, people are satisfied, frustrated, discontent to the contribution and making a sacrifice for outcome of US overseas military intervention. We have to think about the serious division among American society due to the increasing negative side effect of globalization. Minority so that inequality kept increasing and the problem kept deepening. It has all been carried out in the name of international security peace, but in the end was not a price paid by only a small portion of the free land. Would it not be better to focus on one's own national interest, domestic security, and the lives of its own people? This kind of feeling is widespread. It's not only a United States, but also European society alike. It was an eruption of this sentiment that gave a birth to the Trump administration. Seeing from this viewpoint, the appearance of Trump administration itself may be a historical inevitable. It is my feeling. So it is expected that this trend will be pronounced also in a European election of this year. This may be a beginning of historical turning point that reject the democratic internationalism, the even alliance orientation, and the free trade and economic cooperation maintained by international community throughout the post-World War II era. If we think about it in this way. The nature of Trump administration become somewhat understandable. It is not a traditional Republican administration. It does contain some element from Reagan and Nixon administration, but there is no sign of pronounced convictions or national strategy, unfortunately, so far. Impending issues of immigration policy, including construction of wall between US and Mexico, and cooperative tax cut, infrastructure spending, repealing Obamacare, and withdrawing from TPP, not the national strategy, but nothing more than symptomatic treatment measure. For the time being, new administration will make a new policy team, and they will be debating what the strategy to devise the coming age. To US allies, this present an opportunity for policy recommendation to Washington. Even so, there are several noteworthy points among those that the US President addressed during his campaign. First, as you know, there is a notion of American first. More than shared values, this prioritizes the US national interest, which probably imply that allies should shoulder more of responsibility previously carried by US. If so, it becomes imperative for all allied nations to ask the Americans to clearly point out what shared interests they pursue, what significance the alliance holds for them, what role they expect their allies to fulfill. The second, Trump administration, especially although the US will restore and strengthen its military forces, it will not police the world. It may maintain the rebalance, but yet when it comes to vital national interests, the United States is sure to act decisively through hard-hitting type of limited military intervention to share the national interest. Especially in the Middle East, US may turn a blind eye to Russian-Ukraine conflict over Crimea, lifting a Russia strike IS against IS. It will give up the supporting anti-government rebel forces in Syria instead of the Assad control of their country. It may push to scrap a nuclear freeze agreement programs deal with Iran. As a result of this symptomatic treatment, there will be a rift in the US-European relations, antagonism between Iran and Saudi Arabia, and the fear of nuclear proliferation and Russian advancement in the Middle East. I think this is my serious concern. Russia will be seeing a partner that can be negotiated with compromise with the United States. It will seem that President Trump likes to make a deal with a major power, but it is very risky business. On the other hand, it would be a mistake to view the Asia in the same way. The Chinese ambition is hegemony over the India, Indo-Asian Pacific region. It seems that US think it can be a make a deal with China, but that is a mistake. And since Trump administration has not many Asian specialists so far, it is US allies' role to warn them. The thirdly, the Trump administration protectionist economic policy will lead growing inequality and disappointment of the supporter. It is fine if they can resolve the federal deficit through industrial structuring and income redistribution. But the post-Cold War international community has developed, thanks to economic cooperation. Pointing out the problem of protectionism is also allies nation role. New Defense Secretary Mr. Mattis is visit to Japan next week, as you know. Japan intend to reaffirm and emphasize the importance of U.S.-Japan alliance and discuss with Mr. Mattis on how to reinforce alliance cooperation and management between both countries. I personally don't think Mr. Mattis will raise Japan host nation support issue, mainly because new defense secretary probably understood how much our country has a significant financial contribution to the host nation support, which is almost $5 billion US dollars, almost one-tenth of defense budget over the 70% of total operational cost of US force in Japan. However, he may raise additional defense effort, including increasing a defense budget. President Trump, as you know very well, has emphasized US allies has to share the cost as allied nation for the peace and stability in the international community. The five countries among 28 NATO countries reached the defense budget to over 2% of GDP. Japan defense budget is going to under the midterm defense programs by the year of 2018 is expected to increase just only 0.8% in average compared to the previous year. For example, next year, fiscal year 2017, defense budget request is 5,125 billion yen. It's almost $50 billion US dollars, 1.4% increase compared with previous year, 0.926 of GDP. I don't think Mr. Trump satisfied this figure, but large scale of a defense budget is a very important political decision. Government bureaucrat cannot deal with that kind of very important decision by ourselves. But even we increase the defense budget and to purchase American defense equipment, almost 70% of our procurement budget of defense equipment is almost FMS. If we increase this money, our defense industry cannot enjoy the profit. And we cannot expect the rehabilitation or development of technology of our defense industry. So this is my thought that if we increase the defense budget, we would like to make a joint development production programs among nations, such as US, Japan, Australia. And I think that will be also profitable to Japan defense industry. we have to speculate something like a regional conflict mishap between US and neighboring country. Therefore, what Japan need to do is strengthen, reinforce its defense forces while making effort to change the quality of allied cooperation and increase the supplement of function and roles of US forces in Indo-Pacific region. I think this is most important rather than increase in defense budget figure itself. Risks are multi-faced, and there is a need to deal with cyberspace and technological and economic criminal activities to contribute the U.S. third offset strategy. Scientific and technological cooperation is indispensable. Moreover, there is a need for measures that expand U.S.-Japan joint using a base and facility and improve logistic support capacity and operational support capability in the surrounding area to U.S. forces. The most important agenda for our alliance is how U.S. and its allies nation will support and cooperate in order to deal with China, especially their maritime advancement. It is imperative that the U.S. and Japan on the same page when it comes to China strategy as regards the Japanese relations with Trump administration, seeing that they presently lack of a fixed comprehensive strategy, instead pursue the itemized approach, setting up a close-knit consultative body at the highest level to deal with Chinese strategy is a measure of utmost by importance. I have to stop my remarks too long. I quite frankly, I would like to more on a trilateral security relationship in a context of India Pacific region, but I skip. My point is that we have to watch very carefully which direction the new U.S. administration is going to. It is premature to conclude the nature of Trump administration. And we have to wait the policy maker team, not only White House, but also State and Pentagon and some other ministry to make a more comprehensive U.S. strategy. And then we would like to react how to cooperate U.S. Government in the future. So so far, our term, our task is watching very carefully, not to move fast, and also we believe that alliance is still a very important deterrence capability to maintain the peace and stability in the world. I think this is a very simple conclusion, but I think this is the most important element of our security cooperation among three nations. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Professor Morimoto, and I think your remarks have captured not only the depth and the richness of these relationships, particularly the U.S.-Japan alliance, but also the gravity of the issues at stake in getting these relationships right and getting the consultative frameworks right in a changing strategic environment. So thank you for those remarks. I'll you mentioned the question of whether we should give the Trump administration time as we see who begins to fill key positions, not only in the White House, but Pentagon and State as well. So that's kind of a useful note for me with which to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Amy Seawright. And Amy, thank you for making the journey over here from the United States on what I know is a busy schedule. So Dr. Seawright was until recently the Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for South and Southeast Asia from 2014 to 2016, so in the Pentagon, in the Obama administration, and she's had a really exceptional career across a range of agencies in US government, including working in Agency for International Development, other positions, senior positions at DOD, elsewhere in state, and of course positions in the policy and think tank community outside of government as well, Council on Foreign Relations and elsewhere. Presently, she's the director of the Southeast Asia program at CSIS, the Centre for Strategic and International Studies in Washington, D.C. And Amy, I think we're all waiting to hear what you have to say about an American perspective on the issues for consideration here today. Please.
Thank you for inviting me here. It's a pleasure to take part in these discussions. During my time at the Pentagon, I worked on directly on all five of our treaty allies in the Asia Pacific. And since we're on the record, I won't talk about favorite allies, but it is a really great opportunity to talk about these two alliances. You know, what a world we're living in right now. Very interesting times. I think we would be having a very different conversation if we were holding this 6 months ago, when certain kinds of continuity, I think, would be assumed. But now, of course, the elephant in the room, that's already been mentioned many times, so perhaps it's not really an elephant in the room, but it's you know, it is the new president of the United States, President Trump, and the turmoil he is injecting into the geostrategic markets, so to speak. And I'll say a few more words about him in the end. But getting back, stepping back a bit and looking at the U.S.-Japan alliance and the U.S.-Australia alliance, you know, I think it's fair to say they are at real historic high points. The alliances have been modernized and updated according to each ally's strategic outlook. It's changing strategic outlook, and in particular, it's changing perceptions of China. There's been a great amount of effort put into building alliance maritime, cyber, and space capabilities and expanding joint exercises and training. Starting with the U.S.-Japan alliance, this alliance was deepened significantly with the 2015 defense guidelines, which are intended to make alliance cooperation and operations more seamless, flexible, and effective, including in gray zone conflicts, such as the rising tensions that Japan is facing with China in the East China Sea. But also importantly, the guidelines build new areas of cooperation in the alliance in cyber and in space and ballistic missile defense. And the guidelines also envision a regional and global role for the U.S.-Japan alliance in areas like maritime security and peacekeeping and humanitarian assistance and disaster relief operations. And also notable was the new alliance coordination mechanism, the ACM, that was created in the guidelines, so that the alliance will have more seamless and integrated coordination even in peacetime. In addition to the guidelines, there's also been a real effort to improve defense trade and technology sharing in the U.S.-Japan relationship. And the United States Department of Defense has been stationing its most advanced systems in Japan, including Global Hawks, CV-22 Ospreys, and now the first deployments of the F-35 Joint Strike Fighters to Japan, the first deployment in Asia. The U.S.-Australia alliance has long been strong. Australia is perhaps the most reliable ally that the United States has, and the cooperation that we've had in Iraq, Syria, and Afghanistan over the past decade and a half has really strengthened our interoperability in many ways in dealing with these kinds of conflicts. But the alliance took a significant step forward in with the 2014 Force Posture Agreement and the recent cost-sharing agreement that was just recently signed. The Force Posture Agreement provides a long-term framework for rotational marine presence in Darwin and U.S. aircraft rotations at Tyndall, as well as expanding expanded joint training and exercises while these rotational forces and assets are here in Australia. The recent cost-sharing agreement provides the way forward for burden sharing to develop the infrastructure to support the full rotations of Marines and aircraft. And these force posture initiatives really open a new chapter in the alliance, one that shifts the primary focus from discrete operational cooperation in the Middle East to a new focus on alliance cooperation designed to shape a benign security environment in the Indo-Pacific region and deal with a rising peer competitor, namely China, which carries a very different kind of challenge, a much broader set of challenges. As Richard Fontaine put it in a recent article that he wrote on the US-Australia Alliance, it is in Asia where the alliance's greater importance and most difficult tests will likely arise. It's also important to note that US-Australia Alliance cooperation has taken great strides in recent years in maritime security, space, and cyber. And we've had very deep levels of intel sharing, which remains a real critical pillar of the alliance and extremely valuable to both countries. Stepping back from these two alliances and looking more broadly at the US alliance system, it's important to note that in many ways this alliance system has been transforming away from the hub and spoke kind of model to a more network system of alliances and emerging partnerships. Secretary Carter described this emerging architecture as a principled security network, one that ties together our most capable allies, like Japan and Australia, along with a broad network of security partners in the region. But at its core, these high-end, most capable allies, Japan and Australia, are key to maintaining deterrence and continuing to shape the regional security order by maintaining an inclusive architecture, open economies, and adherence to long-lasting rules and norms, including things like freedom of navigation, that have served us all so well over the past seven decades. But a few features of this new, emerging, more networked approach to alliances and partnerships include the following. First, there's been a shift away from the traditional focus on Northeast Asia to include South and Southeast Asia. And here, Australia becomes even more important as a node in this network, given its geographic position and its strong relationships with many countries in the region, but notably the Philippines, Singapore, and Indonesia. Second, this new network really seeks to include emerging partners in exercises and training and in strategic dialogue on key challenges and threats and potential collective responses. So a couple of examples here that I think are particularly noteworthy involve India. First, convincing India to include Japan as a permanent participant in our flagship naval exercise, Malabar, and hopefully we will manage to get Australia included in the coming years. And also engaging in a US-Japan-India trilateral strategic dialogue where there's a lot of focus in that dialogue on long-term maritime security challenges in the Indo-Pacific and how we can work together to address them. And third, there's been a real attempt to try to encourage the spokes in the old hub and spokes alliance network, to encourage the spokes to connect more with each other, to build stronger defense ties and strategic partnerships. And here, the growing strategic partnership between Japan and Australia is a case in point. It's one that has been really applauded by the United States, and some of the recent accomplishments have already been mentioned, the recent ACSA agreement and information sharing agreement, and hopefully a conclusion soon on a reciprocal status of forces agreement. Building more spoke-to-spoke cooperation at the bilateral, trilateral, and multilateral level, I think is really key to this sort of new approach going forward. And trilateral cooperation between the United States, Japan, and Australia is really important here, and I know we're gonna have time to talk about specific trilateral cooperation later this afternoon. But let me just go through a few opportunities that face both alliances and separately, but also our trilateral relationship. First, I think there's opportunities, especially in the maritime domain, when it comes to building interoperability and capabilities in undersea warfare, amphibious capabilities, and intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance. Also, in technological cooperation, the third offset strategy that was announced by the Pentagon 2 years ago aims to offset growing Chinese and Russian military capability by investing in game-changing technologies such as artificial intelligence, unmanned systems, and hypersonics. And I think there are real opportunities to partner with both Australia and Japan as these technologies are being developed. Third, building partner capacity. I think that the recent U.S. Southeast Asia Maritime Security Initiative, which aims to build partner capabilities in Southeast Asia in areas like maritime domain awareness and build up other maritime maritime security capabilities. That provides a real opportunity to work bilaterally or trilaterally with Australia and Japan to coordinate efforts to build up those kinds of capabilities. And finally, there are huge opportunities to work with key emerging partners like India in particular. If true quadrilateral coordination in the maritime domain in the Indo-Pacific could be achieved, that would be a real strategic game changer. But of course, there are many challenges. So what are the challenges? Well, first, there are strategic challenges. China's tactics in the South China Sea, which have included massive land reclamation and building up military infrastructure on these reclaimed outposts, and pointedly rejecting international law, like the recent arbitral tribunal ruling, creates real strategic and tactical challenges in how to effectively counter growing Chinese coercion and how to reassure allies and partners that we've got their back. The combination of China's assertiveness in the South China Sea and its economic overtures has changed the calculations of some countries. The Philippines comes to mind, but many others as well, which really complicates the task of coalition building and building a strong, resilient security network. Another potential strategic challenge could be a divergence in the strategic objectives, especially between the United States and Australia, since Australia itself has some degree of divergence or perceived divergence between its economic and security interests when it comes to China's rise and China's willingness to use economic coercion in the face of a conflict. There are also political challenges. What happens if the underlying political support of these alliances go wobbly? Looking at Japan, Prime Minister Abe looks to be in a very strong domestic political situation, and the security choices that he has made, including much stronger commitments to cooperation in the alliance framework, seems to have pretty solid domestic support. So I think the political concerns here are less immediate, but of course domestic politics in Japan could always shift, and the realignment of forces in Okinawa remain stymied by local political opposition, which could give rise to some bilateral friction that needs to be managed. What about Australia? Well, the US alliance is very popular in Australia. It's very popular in the abstract, but support falls off when Australians are asked about concrete policy choices, such as joining the United States and defending Japan or pushing China from militarized outposts in the South China Sea. So the gap between public opinion and the views of national security elites here in Australia could create some degree of risk that in a contingency, Australian leaders will find their hands somewhat tied. And this risk may be growing if overall public support for the alliance begins to decline in Australia in response to the unpopularity here of Donald Trump and his policies. So this brings me to the new administration under Donald Trump. It's been quite a week. It's hard to believe it's been only 1 week that he has been in office. The big questions we had when he was coming on board is how would he translate his campaign promises into actual policy? And the two campaign promises or rhetoric that I think are most important for Asia were his discussions, what he said about TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and what he said about alliances and burden sharing. Well, on TPP, on day one, he did what he said he would do. He withdrew the United States from TPP. This is a huge strategic setback for the United States, as well as all of the TPP partners. There's very little sign as of yet that Trump and his team will reconsider coming on board TPP, although the logic of U.S. participation in TPP on both economic and strategic grounds remains incredibly strong. And by the way, public polling in the United States continue to show that the TPP has majority support. And some of Trump's supporters that come from rural areas for example, that are heavily dependent on agricultural exports that would have expanded under TPP and maybe hurt in a tit-for-tat kind of trade war or retaliatory episode with China. So, you know, there is still some hope that the logic of TPP will prevail in the end, and we'll get back to figuring out a way to move forward on that. Certainly, we at CSIS are advocating that. We just put out a big report, the Asia Economic Strategy Commission. The commission was chaired by John Huntsman, Charlene Barshefsky, and Evan Greenberg, and it makes a very strong case to move forward on TPP, and you can find it on our website. What about alliances? Well, Trump talked a lot about burden sharing and you know, seemed to question the relevance of alliances. He does appear, in this case, to be backing off from that campaign rhetoric. So, you know, we can be somewhat reassured after his meeting with British Prime Minister Theresa May this week, because apparently he made very favorable comments about NATO. And of course, prior to that, when he was still president-elect, he had his first meeting with a foreign leader, Prime Minister Abe. And now Abe, it's been announced, he's coming to D.C. for his first official visit February the 10th. And it's quite possible that Trump and Abe will hit it off rather well. They may share a view, they may have a shared view of key security threats in the region. And so I think that these are all good signs about where Trump seems to be going on alliances in Asia. President Trump is talking about building up the military, in particular, building up the Navy, going from a 270-ship Navy to 350 ships. This is a massive undertaking that would take two or three decades to achieve. But there also is likely to be, given Republican interest in this in Capitol Hill, there's likely to be greater a focus on greater readiness of U.S. military forces and perhaps bringing more assets to the Indo-Pacific theater. So all of these could create more opportunities for alliance collaboration in the Indo-Pacific. I also think there's reason to expect that we will see more frequent and consistent freedom of navigation operations and presence activities in the South China Sea and the region more broadly, which could be useful, in my view, especially if they are done relatively quietly and let actions speak for themselves rather than tough words. But it's still a big question how confrontational President Trump and his team want to get with China and how China will respond. There was some confusion over the statement that that Rex Tillerson, nominee for Secretary of State, made at his confirmation hearings over the South China Sea. And the presidential spokesperson, I think, muddied the waters even further when he made more comments. I think it added to the ambiguity. I would say that this is more likely stray voltage of an early administration rather than strategy. So I think we probably should reserve judgment until the administration really gets its feet on the ground, gets fully up to speed on the issues, and carefully thinks through their options. But it's worth noting that the Trump team on Asia, I think, is actually shaping up pretty well with General Mattis at the Pentagon and his first announced trip as Secretary of Defense to Asia is a very good sign. And I believe that Rex Tillerson, despite the gaffe, what I would call probably a gaffe at his confirmation hearings, I think he could be very good, very strong on Asia. And we are also hearing a lot of names of some very good people on Asia who may be headed to DOD and state. So the working level could be quite good, which is always really important for alliance management. But there remain a whole lot of unknowns about how this administration will function and what its strategic priorities will be. So for example, will the Trump administration put a lot of investment into continuing to build strategic ties with India and with countries in Southeast Asia like Vietnam and Indonesia and Malaysia? This takes a lot of high-level engagement and a lot of strategic patience in order to make any progress. Also, will the Secretary of State and Secretary of Defense be given wide latitude to formulate and implement policies for Asia with the full backing of the president? Or will pronouncements and tweets from the White House undermine their authority? I think this kind of uncertainty is going to keep us all on our toes in the coming months. But it is worth, I will end on an optimistic note, similar to my colleague at the embassy here. The logic of the rebalance to Asia remains very strong. It's based on the enduring national interests of the United States, and it has strong bipartisan support. So I think we can expect the commitment and focus on the Indo-Pacific region to continue. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Seawright. And that's, I think, a framing for the discussion for the rest of the day. You've identified the state of play with the alliances. You've identified some of the challenges, not only relating to, I guess, Chinese power and assertiveness, but also to the uncertainties that we're seeing within the United States. You've pointed out the political context, but you've also talked about the structural opportunities really to keep building these relationships and really keep, maybe with a bit of patience from allies and partners, getting through a challenging phase. I'm going to, for our final remarks of this session, invite James Goldrick, the Australian speaker. Rear Admiral James Goldrick, now a professor with adjunct roles at a number of institutions, including ANU, Strategic and Defence Studies Centre, has had a very distinguished career in the Royal Australian Navy, including as in command of the Maritime Interception Force in the Persian Gulf, the Australian Defence Force Academy, Australia's Border Protection Command, and the Australian Defence College. And we were colleagues on the Defence White Paper panel last year. James, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Rory, and I'm honoured to have been invited to speak as the Australian in the first session. What I would say is that much of what I've already been thinking about and saying has already been said, and indeed not only have some of the things I was thinking about been said by the earlier speakers, but the paper, The Trump Presidency and Australia's Security, Don't Panic, Don't Relax, by Rory, Marina and the other members of the team, says a lot of what I'm going to say, and therefore I'll try and say it more quickly. I'd only make one point about Rory Marina's paper, seeing that it has the theme of don't panic, and having grown up as a teenager with Hitchhiker's Guide, given the current strategic situation, I think the paper should have had a towel issued with it as well. Because the curse that may you live in interesting times hit with a vengeance in 2016. Now, I was in America for a previous presidential election between a Clinton and a George H.W. Bush in what I can only describe as a very, very strong Republican environment. And in that Republican environment, I seemed to be the only person watching the inevitable train smash happen of a Clinton victory and a Bush defeat, as far as the Republicans were concerned. And the line that struck me about Mr. Clinton that was going to get it was, "It's the economy, stupid." Well, I would say that the theme for what is going to happen over the next few years, and indeed for the Trump presidency, is it's the domestic electorate, stupid. And actually that applies, I think, for all three countries in this situation. So much of what is going to happen is going to be driven by domestic politics and how it will play domestically. More so, I think, in terms of international relations than has been the case for quite a few years. Now, we've talked about the potential unpredictability, and I think this will be a very serious question for America's allies and partners. And it's not simply an unpredictability of what is done, it is going to be a constant unpredictability of what is said. We are going to have to find ways of effectively understanding what is the significance and what is meant by tweets, interviews and speeches. Indeed, I suspect the whole industry is going to be set up akin to the old Kremlinologists who would work out exactly what the Russians were saying in the Cold War. I would say that, however, it's true that the Obama administration in regards to China, for instance, may have been a little too predictable and a little too cautious in its treatment of China. And perhaps a little unpredictability might not always be a bad thing. Furthermore, although our government has had a setback over the TTP, the indication that the recent executive order on limiting entry to the United States was modified at Australia's request to protect the agreement reached in relation to our offshore camps, must be encouraging for the Australian government, and I suspect will be encouraging for other governments who are watching how these things work. So a deal with Mr. Trump may indeed be a deal, but I think that's another problem for the future of the alliances, because I think the greatest long-term concern for Australia, and Morimoto-san has, I think, touched it from a Japan viewpoint, is the possibility that the Trump administration might well do deals with powers like China and Russia. It has to be accepted as a possibility. These might suit the United States government's short-term goals, but could fundamentally alter the nature of the strategic framework in Asia. We need to find ways of ensuring that it is understood by those who matter in Washington that the longer-term interests of the United States not simply justify, but demand a continued leadership role in this region. Now, successive Australian governments have had a much more robust relationship with the United States counterparts in private than has sometimes been apparent to the Australian public, or to indeed to other nations. And it's actually been a tension in our relationships, I think, with ASEAN. It's been particularly so since 9/11, with constant and increasingly close exchanges allowing common policy to be worked through behind the scenes on many questions, and the limits of Australian support made very clear to the United States. If the Trump administration pursues a less consultative approach, Australia will need to become more public in expressing its opinion on an American initiatives that it does not wholly support. I think this is going to be vital. But given that this is a problem faced by all America's allies and long-term partners at the moment, as we now see playing out in the North American neighbourhood, and Canada, I think, is having to watch things very carefully just at the moment, I think it's unlikely to be the subject of particular tension between Australia and the United States. But it will add a dimension to the relationship which it has not had for many years. Japan is in a very similar situation, or rather a parallel situation, because I think the points of tension won't always be the same. But I want to get back to this domestic element, and it's been touched on by Dr. Seawright. It is mentioned in the paper in relation to domestic opinion. The domestic element for both Australia and Japan in managing their relationship with the United States will not and cannot be ignored. Particularly in Australia, there's no doubt there are substantial elements of the population who are in strong sympathy with the populist approach endorsed by the Trump administration, the sort of things that are being said. But there are equally large groups who are either ill at ease or very strongly opposed to many elements of what seems to be the president's platform. Certain decisions and certain rhetoric, and I get back to it's the uncertainty about what is said, is as much of a problem in many ways as the uncertainty of what is done. Social media has now become a reality of its own. Could very easily increase the levels of anti-American feeling, or at least I would actually specify not anti-American feeling, but anti-US administration feeling and anti-US alliance feeling. I think there are different aspects to the Australian relationship with America, which is always a complex one. But they could increase the levels of anti-American feeling, and I think 45% the Lowy poll that's quoted, 45% of Australians said they would have concerns with the Trump administration. This could influence both decision-making and electoral platforms. The triggers will not be the same for Japan, but I think the same situation could develop. Now, we can hope, and you know, there is this hope for business as usual, that a conspiracy of selective moderation, to use my own phrase, may well have to develop between the governments of America's partners and elements of the Trump administration. And I would agree with Dr. Seawright, not only General Mattis, who I think is greatly admired in Australia and is a man whose US Marine Corps facade should never be confused with an intellect that's really remarkable. It's worthwhile not just seeing who's appointed, but go and look at who's been going to see President Trump, not always with much publicity. There are some seriously serious players talking to him. But the moderation will necessarily be extremely selective because Mr. Trump's domestic credibility is largely based on his not necessarily accepting the status quo in any situation. So the trick is going to be to manage the second and third order consequences. Personal relationships will obviously matter a great deal in the years ahead. And if Australia and Japan have been spending a lot of time in Washington in the last decade, they're going to have to spend a great deal more because the pressure points are changing. But there are people being brought into the cabinet and the upper levels of the administration who have a great deal of substance within their public form. As to opportunities, however good its intent, we've got to accept that Australia is going to be constrained by its own economic situation, and even though we're a big country, we're not that big. We face the need to reshape the national economy. Whether that's going to work depends as much on external developments as internal effort. But I think we need to be much more active in managing our strategic environment in a way that has the relationship with the United States as a key element, but the rhetoric, the theme, the public image is much more of our recognition of complexity. Our uncertain future calls for a much more active, or in fact, it's not so much that we need to actually be more active, but we've got to be seen to be a great deal more active than I think we have been in the last 10 years in multilateral terms, dealing with other nations. While India speaks of its look east policy evolving to one of act east, I think we need to act outwards. Japan's situation has certain similarities. It has political and economic constraints that require both attention to the domestic situation and a willingness to adopt a much more active approach to regional problems. It also needs to be seen to act outwards. So we may need to take the Trump administration at its word and both do more ourselves and to encourage others to burden share, both in a military sense and indeed in wider efforts to contribute to regional and national security and stability. And arguably, the development of closer links in the management of many international challenges, and I would speak for Japan and Australia that I think we need to do much more together in the Southwest Pacific than we have in the past, even though we've done a lot, may be much more straightforward and should be given much more publicity than the measures for a deeper military relationship focused on improving shared capability for high-intensity operations. And Dr. Searight touched on the areas where I think we not only need to be working with the United States, but Japan and Australia need to be working to have much closer relationships and much closer operation. And I would say one mechanical problem, we need to talk to the United States about information release restrictions, so we're not caught in bilateral arrangements with the United States, which means we can't talk to Japan and vice versa. Let me just finish with touching on the South China Sea. I know it's going to be the next session, but I think it's so important that we do need to talk about it now. We do need to work out mutual understandings as to what are the real issues in the South China Sea. Acquiescence to ambit Chinese claims would not only be highly undesirable in their immediate strategic consequences, particularly for ASEAN and UNCLOS, but also in the longer-term implications of what has been termed learned bad behaviour might encourage coerciveness in other matters. On the micro scale, managing the South China Sea problem may include giving the new White House press secretary a crash course in the terminology of international law, but there are wider aspects. The real problem is not the possession of individual rocks or reefs. And I think we need to get away from focusing on a paradigm of freedom of navigation exercises which deal with a particular aspect of UNCLOS. The real problem is whether the sea might become a sea closed to all but the Chinese and to those who accept whatever rules China may set. Although we've heard much less of the term from China since the International Tribunal's decision, the ambiguous nine-dash line contains at least the implication that this is China's long-term intent. For this reason, our key response should be not only and not so much the simple assertion of rights of passage within territorial waters, but repeated and substantial naval deployments and joint exercises involving the other littoral states and their extra-regional partners. Now, Australia's been doing these since World War II. We have been operating with Malaysia and Singapore since those two countries' independence. Indeed, we have been conducting exercises within the nine-dash line for that period and continue to do so. And I think we need both to make more of that and to do more of it. And I think Japan and the United States need to seek opportunities to be seen to be doing that sort of thing as well. But let me just conclude with saying again that it's about the domestic electorate. And I think the points that are made about needing to explain what we're doing and why we're doing and create much more confidence in the public eye in all three countries is actually a vital task for governments and indeed for all the sort of people who are sitting here today. Thank you.
James, I think that was a really powerful and illuminating view of the problems, the problem set, and I certainly take your caveat about our don't panic advice. I think don't relax is certainly the counter to that. Look, we've got only a couple of minutes, and I know morning tea is waiting, but I did also promise the opportunity for a little bit of a chance to at least put a question to our speakers. So I'm going to take just three questions from the group. I'll take them just as a sequence of three questions and give the speakers an opportunity to respond to those questions, but very briefly, please. So please, if you have a question, please raise your hand, get a microphone, introduce yourself, and just a nice, succinct question, not a statement, please. Any questions? Or are we all stunned into silence? Please.
Nina Silov, Strategic and Defence Studies Centre here at ANU. I have a quick question for Amy. I'm always curious when the Obama administration described this network model that they didn't use any adjectives to describe what the role of the United States in that model is. I wonder if you would be willing to offer us some.
Okay, thank you, Nina. We'll come back to that for Amy. And I think Michael Shoebridge from Department of Defence. I've called you out there.
My question is for James and the rest of the panel. How do we ensure that talking more about what we're doing and why we're doing it doesn't increase the risk of a gap between those political positions and policy?
Thank you. And we'll take one more question. I think that's Richard from the
Richard Aydarin from Philippines. Maybe to Rear Admiral and Professor Goldrick. You said that given the strategic restraint and predictability of the Obama administration, perhaps a little bit of unpredictability under Trump administration could sometimes be good. Could you elaborate on that? In what sense could unpredictability be a good thing? Because I think that was the most interesting comment.
Okay. I might start with Amy, Dr. Seawright.
Thanks for the question. I'm not sure I have a great answer, or maybe I don't fully understand the question, but we did talk... under the Obama administration, there was a lot of talk about the principled security network and networking alliances and partnerships. And if you look at the way the United States' role was characterized in speeches that secretaries of defense made at Shangri-La over recent years, there still was a lot of talk about American leadership. I don't know if they used the word indispensable nation, but that's bandied about a lot as well. So I think implicit, at least, in the characterization of the United States in the rebalance and in attempting to encourage the formation of this broad security network is the idea that the United States should continue to play a key role in leading and bringing some of this together. But I think there's also some attempt to move away from the idea that this is all about hub and spokes or that this is all about the United States organizing the region because, first of all, you want to counter the narrative out there pushed by some that the United States is really trying to militarize the South China Sea or militarize the region. And we really want to emphasize the collective benefits that come to all of us in the region, including China, in terms of adherence to longstanding rules and norms, like the ones I mentioned, open economies, freedom of navigation, open, inclusive architecture. These are collective benefits for everyone. And so we kind of wanted to move away a little bit from making it sound as this is all American-led or, American values or leadership, because it's really joint.
James Goldrick,
first to the uncertainty question, I actually spent the day the election results were coming in at lunch with the Chancellor and the former Chinese Foreign Minister, and he and his entourage. It was very interesting, their reaction. I haven't talked with any Chinese in the last week, but I have talked with a number in the last couple of months. It is quite clear that there is an uncertainty and a desire in China just to work out how this is all going to go, because China does fear doing something which might create catastrophic consequences. That uncertainty and caution is not a theme I was seeing 12 months ago. The confidence has gone. Now, there are dangers in it. I fully acknowledge that. Michael, I think I get back to this issue of explanation. And I suppose the subtext of your question and the answer is it's actually fundamentally a political problem. I think our politicians have to get, all of our politicians have to get a lot better at explaining to our peoples what we're doing and why. I think there has been a failure of language. I will say that this is, a realisation Rory and I and the other team came to. There's also fundamentally an ethnic diversity problem here. I think all of our security establishments have got themselves within something of an echo chamber, in which a lot of people in our fast, in the demographics changing a very fast, changing very fast in Australia and America, a lot of people are totally outside that echo chamber. And it's, we've seen one aspect in how Trump's gone, but there's a lot of people who have very different views who are also outside that chamber, who are not committed and will take a lot of persuasion.
So before we conclude, Professor Morimoto, I'm not sure if you have any responses to the questions that have been put, but I might also put one additional question to you, sir, which is how worried do you think the Japanese officials and the Japanese government is about this question of unpredictability in the Trump administration, and what can Japan do about it?
Well, I quite frankly, I don't know exactly what kind of anxiety or concern for our government has. But my personal concern on the uncredibility or uncertainty to the trend of Trump administration is the future prospect of US-China relationship. Especially, I worry about the President Trump may make a deal and a compromise between both countries at a secret base in a small room by tete-a-tete meeting without any information out of blue. Especially US-China trade imbalance, the exchange rate, some sort of from China. On the other hand, I think if the US will be going to deal with G's concern, I think China may raise South China Sea issues or East China Sea issues or Taiwan relations, or support to North Korea. So what kind of deal between both top leader under the small room, like Kissinger type of compromise, without any notification to US allies? I think this is my personal concern. I may not be wrong, but I don't know. This is my personal.
Well, thank you. I think, Professor, you've left us with something, I think, quite significant to think about there. We're going to conclude the session now. You've all been patient because I know morning tea is waiting outside, but I think these were three really important presentations worth listening to. So please join me in thanking our speakers.